Hello friends, welcome to my biology class. Today's discussion is on sexual reproduction in flowering plants. This is the second chapter of class 12 biology. Today's discussion will be on topic pollination. What we'll study in this session? We shall study the definition of pollination. We shall study the different types of pollination with their proper definition. We'll try to understand the differences between self-pollination and cross-pollination. We will learn the advantages and disadvantages in self-pollination and cross-pollination. We will study the flowers which are pollinated by wind or by insect or by water. And finally, we will discuss those characteristics of a flower which helps in the cross-pollination. Let us start the discussion with this definition. What is pollination? Pollination is the transfer of pollen grains from anther to the stigma of a flower. In sexual reproduction, after formation of gamete, next is transfer of the gametes. So here, pollination is the transfer of those pollen grains from the male part to the female part. Now, this transfer may occur within the same flower, it may occur between the flowers of the same plant, or it may occur between flowers which are borne on two different plants. Now, pollination is required for fertilization. Fertilization is when the two gametes meet. For this, transfer of the pollen grain onto the stigma is required. We will discuss in details of fertilization in our next video. Now we will study about pollination. So, pollination will result into fertilization, and the product of fertilization is the fruit, the seeds, which we will be studying later on. Types of pollination. Self-pollination. Under self-pollination, we have autogamy and gametogamy. And second type is cross-pollination. So we mainly will study self-pollination and cross-pollination. Under self-pollination, we shall study autogamy and gametogamy. Let us start with autogamy. Auto means self. What happens here? The pollen grains are transferred from the anther to the stigma of the same flower. So naturally, these flowers are bisexual. Here both the stamens and the pistils are present. In nature, there are various or different types of self-pollinating plants. Now, even in the plants having both types of gamete-forming organs like the pistil and the stamens, they may not be able to self-pollinate. There are certain conditions where self-pollination is obligatory or it is a must. For example, in cleistogamous flowers. What are these cleistogamous flowers? These are those flowers where the flower do not open. So the flower remains closed always, and under such condition, cross-pollination is not possible. So these flowers are completely self-pollinated. Here you can see the example. This is a camelina. This plant is camelina. It has both chiasmogamous flowers, which opens, and cleistogamous flowers, which do not open. Some common examples are camelina, viola, and oxalis. These are called as cleistogamous flower. Do remember this term. Cleistogamous flower means flowers which do not open. And in cleistogamous flower, autogamy is a must. Come to gametogamy. This is another type of self-pollination. But here, what happens? The difference is, that is, pollen of one flower is transferred to the stigma of another flower. But in this case, both the flowers are different but bound on the same plant. In the earlier case, it was within the same flower, and here it is between the two flowers which are on the same plant. This transfer may occur between the male flower. It may so happen that the plant has male flowers and female flowers. That is, flowers are unisexual. And both the flowers are born on the same plant. So this is also a gametogamy, because they are both genetically same. These plants are called as monoecious plants. Next is advantages. Is there any advantage of cell pollination? Of course, some advantages and disadvantages they have. Number one is, advantages, here the pollination rate is very high. Next, purity is maintained. That is, genetical purity is maintained. Why? Because there is no mixing of traits. Here, the flowers need not be large, showy, or develop any features to encourage pollination, means to attract any pollinating agents. So all these things are not required. Smaller number of pollen grains are sufficient even for attaining higher success rate of pollination. In such flowers, there is no dependency on external factors. External factor means here the agents. They don't require any agents for pollination. Next come to the disadvantage. Now we have seen some advantages. Let's study some disadvantages. The most important disadvantage of self-pollination is inbreeding depression. Inbreeding depression, since it is self-pollinated, no new combination of genes are coming onto the next generations. This keeps on self-pollinating, and they ultimately give rise to weaker offsprings. This is called as inbreeding depression. Now, due to self-pollination, we cannot develop any new varieties or species. Next come to cross-pollination. Now, in cross-pollination, the pollen is transferred from one flower to the flower borne on the other plant. That means the two flowers are borne on two different plants. Such type of pollination will be called as xenogamy or allogamy. In the previous case, in gametogamy, the two flowers were borne on the same plant, but here in cross-pollination, the two flowers are borne on two different plants. Advantages and disadvantages. Some advantages includes, there is mixing of new traits, and so new varieties can be developed. Due to cross-pollination, we can have healthier plants. These are called as hybrid vigor. This is a solution to self-sterile plants to produce seeds. Those plants which are self-sterile, for them, cross-pollination is the only way how they can produce fertile seeds. Disadvantages. The greatest disadvantage is, this plant requires certain adaptive features. Just for example, so that they can attract the pollinating agents. Here pure lines are not maintained. Naturally, every time there is a cross-pollination, there will be new combinations of genes. Now, while doing so, certain unwanted or undesired traits may also appear in the offsprings. Now let us study those features of a plant which promotes cross-pollination. Now, bisexual flowers, in fact, they have a natural tendency for self-pollination. Though we find that there are several bisexual flowers where cross-pollination occurs, That means, being bisexual flower, they don't have self-pollination. Why such? Let us now try to understand what makes such flowers to opt for cross-pollination. Number one, heterostyly. Hetero means different, means when styles and filaments differ in their length. This is very natural, that if styles and filaments, they differ in their length, then what will happen? That is, the anther and the stigma will not lie on the same level. Or even if the anther lies bit above the level of the stigma, then still pollination is possible. But if they differ markedly in their size, in their length, then they may not be, it may not be possible for pollination. Say for example, the filaments are too small, styles are too long. At that time, it is never possible. Next come to hercogamy. Hercogamy, here what happens? Certain physical barrier exists between the stamen and the pistil, due to which such type of self-pollination is never possible. They opt for cross-pollination. There are some others, like dichogamy. Dichogamy means time of maturation of the anther and the stigma. Now, when it can be so that anther matures first, stigma matures later on, or the vice versa. When both of them do not mature at the same time, then self-pollination and fertilization is not possible. Now, we have two terms here. Try to understand and learn these two terms. That is, when the pistil matures before the anther, it is called as protogyny. And when the anther matures before the stigma, it is called as protandry. Next point is self-incompatibility. This is also called as self-sterility. What is this? Incompatibility means the inability. Inability of what? It is the inability of the fertile pollens to fertilize the same flower. Some genetic reasons may be there, or barriers are there, due to which the flower is not pollinated by the same gametes. Under such circumstances, it is necessary that the flower opts for cross-pollination. Male sterility. What is this? In certain flowers or in certain species, the pollen grains becomes non-functional. This male sterility, male part is sterile, due to which self-pollination is not possible and they opt for cross-pollination. Another term is declining. That is, unisexual flowers. Monoecy and diecy, you are already aware of these two terms. Diecy means when staminate and pistillate flowers are present on two different plants, dioecious species. When it is so, the staminate and pistillate flowers, they are unisexual flowers, so they must opt for cross-pollination. So, staminate and pistillate flowers born on two different plants, this will be called as diecious. And for such plants or such flowers, cross-pollination is the only choice. Now let us come to this table. See here, pollination, two types. This part we have already discussed, autogamy and gametogamy. Now we'll discuss the agents of pollination. Agents are required not for self-pollination, it is required for cross-pollination. So, the agents can be divided into biotic factors and abiotic factors. So, abiotic and biotic. Under abiotic factors, we will study wind pollination. This is called as anemophily. We will study water pollination. This is called as hydrophily. Living beings or the biotic factors can be entomophily, where insects are the agents, chiropterophily, the bats are the agents, malacophily, the snails are the agents, and ornithophily, where birds are the agents. Now let us see. Pollen is transferred from stigma to a different plant. So from one plant to another plant, the pollination is to be made. So the pollen grain has to be transferred. Now in angiosperms, both the pollen grains and of course the male and the female part both are non-motile. If it is so, then certain media is required to transfer them. So to travel such distance, then what to do? Some travel agents are required. These travel agents will carry the pollen grains from the pollen sac to the stigmas. These agents are divided into two main groups we have just discussed. Some are abiotic agents and some are biotic agents. Anemophily or wind pollination. Since the pollen grains are to be carried away to far off distance by wind current, then what is to be done? Certain spatial adaptations are required, which will require exposure of the both the stamens and the pistils. This exposure is possible when there is reduced the floral parts, like the calyx and corolla. They will have to produce large number of pollen grains because most of the pollen grains will be wasted when they will be carried away by the wind. What should be the features? These flowers, you can see this, the spikelet of Poaceae family can be paddy, wheat. You see, the flowers are very simple with very exposed. You see the anthers, they have long filaments, and you see the ovary, stigmas are highly feathered. These reduction in the accessory holes helps the both the part, male and the female part, to expose into the air so that they can be carried away, pollen grains can be carried away, and the feather stigma can act as an antenna to capture the floating pollen grains along with the wind. So these flowers are small, colorless, odorless, and also don't require nectar because they are not going to attract anyone. Here the calyx corolla are highly reduced. Just now I have said pollen grains are small, dry, numerous, dusty, and often winged so that it can be blown to long off distances. Stamens have long filament with versatile anther. Stigma are exposed and feathery so that they can catch the pollen grains in the air. Male flowers are more than the female flowers. Again, the same reason, because most of the pollen grains will be wasted. This is very common in maize, paddy, sugarcane, bamboo, coconut palm, etc. Come to hydrophily or water pollination. Water pollination, don't think that every plant growing in water is water pollinated. There are certain plants growing in water, which aquatic plants, where pollination is not hydrophily, is not done by water. For example, in the lilies, water lily, it is wind and insect. But in aquatic plants, these are submerged plants, hydrilla, zostera, vericinaria, here water is the only medium for pollination. They have certain adaptive features, like flowers are small, colorless, and odorless. Floral parts do not get wet. This is very, very important. Stigmas are long and sticky type so that they can easily attack. For example, in Zostera, which is a marine plant, it remains submerged. They have long pollen grains. They are devoid of exine. They float below the water surface. But when they come in contact with the stigma, they coil around it and then germinate. Next we come to Vallisneria. In the previous slide, this is Vallisneria, an aquatic plant. This is submerged. Male and female plants are separate here. On maturation, the male flowers get detached and float on the water surface. Now, since the water surface, the male flowers are floating, they float and ultimately reach to the sticky stigma of the female flowers. Now, these flowers, female flowers, are not detached. They remain attached by long stalks. Male flowers, as they reach the female flower, they burst their anthers and pollination is done. So pollination here occurs on the water surface. As soon as pollination is over, the female flowers are pulled down into the water due to coiling of the long stalks. Next is entomophily. Or these are called as entomophilous flowers. It is very natural that these flowers have to develop certain adaptive features so that they can attract the insects. Butterflies, beetles, bee, moth, etc. These are some very common agents. So let us see what are those adaptive features. Here the flowers are usually large. Why large? Because it has to provide a landing spot for the insects or the butterflies or whosoever is coming here. Flowers have to be showy, then only they will be attractive, colorful. But there are certain flowers which are small and are insect pollinated. In such flowers you will find that they are found to be in clusters. When they form clusters, then naturally the landing ground increases. Even in some cases, the colorful bracts, they also solve the purpose of attraction. In cases where the petals are not attractive, bracts also can solve the problem. These flowers are highly scented so that they are attracted. They provide nectar to the visitors. Certain flowers we find that the pollen grains are also eaten by the insects, rose and magnolia. This is the attraction for the pollinators. What happens actually is these surface of the pollen grains are spiny or sticky, so that as soon as the insect enters into the flower, these pollen grains can get stuck on its body surface. In Viola, there are special margins on petals which attracts the insects. There is relationship with the color of the flower and the insect's visitors. Moths, for example, they are mostly attracted by white color flowers, while butterflies and wasps, they are more attracted by red color flowers. Angiosperm pollen also possesses pollen kit. This pollen kit is a yellow sticky substance which is an insect attractor. So when the insect visits the flower, this pollen kit, they get attached to the body of the insect. Now, next is bird pollination. You can see here this picture where a hummingbird is sucking nectar. Small birds like parrots, hummingbird, sunbird, crow, even bulbuls, these are pollinators. These flowers are called as ornithophilous. These flowers have some special adaptation so that birds are attracted. They are naturally large in size and have a funnel-shaped corolla. This is an important characteristic. Funnel-shaped corolla, so that the birds can enter their beak into it. These flowers are usually very bright. The reason being, this brightness helps visibility from a very long of distance. Mostly these flowers are red, blue, orange, yellow, etc. And these are all bright colors. These flowers, they have abundant nectar, more nectar than possessed by insect pollinated flowers. Yes, stamen and pistil are so oriented that they can easily contact the pollinators. These flowers are usually drooping or hanging type. They don't have fragrance. Some common examples are bottle brush, scientific name is Calystemon, Butea, Bombax, Bignonia, etc. Now we come to one more pollinator, which are the bats. This is called as Chiroptera. Since the bats, they are the nocturnal mammals, so naturally they will visit at nights only. Since the bats, they fly to large distances, so they are able to transport the pollen grains also to long distances. These bat pollinated flowers, they have some certain adaptive features. For example, these flowers are strongly scented, but they are dull colored. They produce huge amount of nectar, and the flowers usually open after sunset. Reason being, bats are nocturnal. Some examples are Adansonia, Anthocephalus, Bauhinia, and Kigelia. Very important, these are very often asked. Now with this, we have actually completed the discussion on pollination. Now while discussing, we discussed some technical terms along with the pollinators. Now it is your turn to write the technical term for pollination by wind, by water, by insect, by bird, and by bats. Answer is anemophily for wind, hydrophily for water, entomophily for insects, ornithophily for birds, chiroptera for bats. Now in this, you must write some specific characters, which we will not do right now, but you just try to recollect at least two such specific characters of flowers. For example, what are the specific characters of wind pollinated flowers? The must points you must write here. There are several points, but out of those, you select those points which are very, very specific. Before we complete this session, here we have some take home questions. Very simple ones. We have discussed all these. Number one, differentiate between heterogamy and cross pollination. Number two is write the characteristic features of flowers pollinated by insect, water, and wind. And third is enlist the factors which promotes cross pollination in angiospermic flowers. Do write the answers at home, check it also, and repeat if required. Before I leave, let me again remind you that the next topic on this chapter is fertilization, means double fertilization, and post-fertilization development. Here we will study post-fertilization development. What are these which happens? One is embryo formation and another is endosperm formation. So in the next video, you will have discussion on double fertilization and post-fertilization development. So now I leave. Thank you very much for being with me.